I have known Professor Fayaz Bakar for over 30 years, and as you would discover, that he's a very hard taskmaster. But I never expected that he will treat me also like his students and give me the task of compressing my 67 years of working career into 50 minutes, which means not even a minute for each year. Let me attempt this Herculean task and leave it to you to judge how far I have succeeded. Those of you who have read Shakespeare, the first scene of his plays opens with a dire yell, making the audience to sit up as to what is coming next. I thought the best way to attract your attention would be to follow Shakespeare. So, if you allow, I will begin my task and my talk by showing you a video of my speech given at the United Nations Sustainable Development Annual Session in 2009.
Madam Chair, Excellencies, I am indeed most grateful to Madam Chair for inviting me to speak at the 17th session of the Commission on Sustainable Development. When I look back on over 55 years of my working life in government, United Nations, Aga Khan Foundation, and rural support programs, my greatest successes and satisfaction were when I succeeded in forging genuine and meaningful partnerships with communities. Over 50 years ago, my mentor, Akhtar Hamid Khan, about whom Nobel laureate Professor Yunus wrote, "It is not enough to say that he was a great man. He was one of the great human beings of the past century. He was so much ahead of everybody else that he was seen more as a misfit than appreciated for his greatness. We have a lot to discover and a whole lot to learn from him." Akhtar Hamid Khan taught me my first lessons in forging partnerships with communities. But it is only during the last 30 years that I got the opportunity, thanks initially to UNCRD and then to UNICEF and later to UNDP, but mainly to His Highness the Aga Khan, to fully and exclusively devote myself interacting with the communities in Pakistan, Bangladesh, India, Maldives, Nepal, and Sri Lanka. Over this period, I have personally held dialogues with over 5,000 communities, and this morning I intend to share this experience with you. I still vividly remember the bitterly cold December in 1982 when I drove 600 kilometers from Islamabad to Gilgit on a borrowed jeep. This was the beginning of the Aga Khan Rural Support Program, AKRSP, and forging of partnerships over the next 12 years with a million people in one of the most inhospitable and harshest terrain anywhere in the world. I brought them a simple message, but time-tested, from the days of Raiffeisen in Germany in 19th century Europe, followed by Japan, Taiwan, Comilla, and South Korea's Samol Undong. This was a message of partnership and development. The KRSP was not there to listen to their demands, needs, and problems and offer solutions. The KRSP offered them only a methodology, an approach, a social guidance to overcome their handicaps themselves. The villagers used to look at me with disbelief. A program bearing the name of one of the richest person in the world, not willing to solve their problems and asking them to do things first. I explained, this is a partnership which entails obligations on both sides. And unless the community and the poor were prepared to fulfill their obligations, how can the partnership be formed? Many were impatient and would pester me to tell them what was the limit to which the program would help them if they accepted the terms of partnership. And my simple response used to be, your limit is our limit. Whatever the community can do or was willing to do, was the program limit. I was very happy when the approach was reinforced by the first World Bank assessment of AKRSP in 1987, saying that the first 4 years of AKRSP are the missed 4 years of most rural development projects in the world, where blueprint took precedence over a process approach. AKRSP did not go to the communities with the preconceived package and left it to each community to identify their potential, not only as a community, but also at the household level. The 1 million people I worked with for 12 years in northern areas of Pakistan through the Aga Khan Rural Support Program reinforced my conviction of the tremendous potential and willingness in people to do many things themselves to come out of poverty. All that they were needed was a support organization to help them unleash their potential. Once organized, the men and women took their destiny in their own hands. They knew what would bring them out of poverty. They planted 50 million trees on land brought under irrigation range, generated about 6 megawatts of electricity through village built and managed mini hydels, acknowledged as the biggest concentration of community managed micro hydro projects anywhere in the world. In agriculture, horticulture, livestock, the organized communities made quantum jump in introducing and later marketing apple varieties from California and cherries from France. Their apricot is picked up by a London buyer from the farm gate at Gilgit. Their initiative in protecting wildlife in collaboration with IUCN, and I'm glad that DG IUCN is here, and WWF was given rich dividends, sharing 75% of the proceeds of trophy hunting with the government wildlife department. The tourists can now watch ibex, marhor, and if they're lucky, even sometimes snow leopard from the roadside. Last time on my visit to northern areas, I went to a village, Ahmedabad, where 22 years ago I had gone sitting in a basket pulled across the river as there was no bridge on the river. The village with 110 households was totally isolated, although the Karakoram Highway passed by it. The village had no access, no road, no school, no health facility, no potable drinking water, and no electricity. Today, it has everything. These people would never have been touched, Madam Chair, by any growth strategy or macro planning. They needed a development strategy which involved each and every household in the development process. Unfortunately, this is what our macro planners failed to comprehend. When I asked these people what was the secret of their success, their response was, "We got organized." The village roads were earmarked with dustbins, and the environment was litter-free. According to the Second World Bank evaluation of AKRSP, in 10 years, the income of the people of northern areas had in real terms more than doubled. In 1994, when UNDP asked me to take lessons learned in northern areas of Pakistan to South Asia, India being the largest country in the region, it was the greatest challenge to South Asia Poverty Alleviation Program, SAPEP. And to me personally, as a Pakistani, to make a difference to the lives of women and their households in India. My apprehensions were baseless. The people of Andhra Pradesh and the state government welcomed me with open arms and treated me with unforgettable kindness, hospitality and affection, and continues to do so. In Andhra Pradesh, I was told that after 7 years, almost 75% of the organized households had risen above the level of subsistence. When I doubted this statement, the women insisted on taking me to their homes. I visited a number of houses which I had visited in my first visit in 1995, which had barely any amenities of life available. I was wonderstruck to find modern amenities like television, telephone, toilets, etc. in the houses. In one house, I did not see television, and I asked the lady if she had been left behind others. She asked me to visit her backyard where more than 35 goats were standing. She explained her children are young and unlike other children do not insist on going to the neighbors to see the television. Hence, she made her choice of preferring goats to the television. This reminded me of Nobel laureate Amartya Sen's book, Development as Freedom. One of the important outcomes of mobilized communities in Andhra has been the adoption of Community Managed Sustainable Agriculture, CMSA. To date, adopted by over 300,000 farmers, It has enabled the poor to break out of the exploitative relations with moneylenders, fertilizer and pesticides traders. In the next 5 years, the Society for Elimination of Rural Poverty of Andhra plans to take it to 10 to 12 million acres, covering 50 to 60% of the cultivable area of the state. The environmental benefits of CMSA are enormous. It will convert the state into a green state with impact on climate change and global warming. However, the main motivation for the poor for adopting these practices is the quantum jump in their net incomes. The lesson is that however good the technology may be, without people's involvement through their strong grassroots institutions, it will remain in the laboratories and universities. We need a pupil-centered solution to food security and climate change. The Andhra government keeps on inviting me, and this July, last July when I went, I found 10 million rural households comprising 45 million people who already had access more than $1 billion last year from the commercial banks. Andhra has been able to demonstrate an approach of poverty reduction encompassing over 45 million people, which has no parallel anywhere in South Asia. Andhra has found the solution to rural poverty. Today, the rural support programs network in Pakistan extend to 93 out of 125 districts of Pakistan, making a difference to the livelihood of nearly 13 to 15 million people. Pakistan is probably the only country in South Asia which has adopted social mobilization as was recommended by the Poverty Commission in 1991. A new chapter of development seems to be opening up to take lessons learned to scale in Pakistan. The federal government is very keen to mainstream social mobilization. The President of Pakistan gave his approval to the approach for countrywide replication in next 3 to 5 years in December 2008. At the recent Friends of Pakistan donor meeting hosted by Japan, $3 billion were pledged exclusively for poverty reduction in the next 2 years. Madam Chair, if sustainable development leading to elimination of poverty has to be assured in, governments of the third world will have to take a lead role in fostering a framework of grassroots institutions of the people.
The video was intended to give you an overall view of what I have been doing since 1982. Let me now trace the background of the theory, strategy and principles of subsistence holders' development in rural setting. Looking at Pakistan, analyzing the background of the institutional transformation of rural areas during the British days, what Pakistan inherited was a law and order administration, and of course it was concentrated on revenue collection and mega projects like railways and roads and the largest irrigation system of the world, Indus system. The only rural transformation initiative was launching of a rural reconstruction programs in the 20s of the last century by a gentleman called F.L. Brain. And the assumption that he made that rural population is sitting idle and they can be mobilized through self-help to improve rural condition, little realizing that these people also have to earn a livelihood. In fact, Akhtar Hamid Khan dubbed it as a program which did not cost government anything and did not achieve anything. When Pakistan became independent, the first rural development program was launched by the United States aid agencies, which was called the Village Agriculture and Industrial Development, Village Aid, they nicknamed it, program. It was an important improvement on the erstwhile rural reconstruction project of the British. It envisaged introducing a village aid worker as a friend, philosopher and guide in every village, and expected that every government department to deliver their services and supplies to the village in accordance with the demands generated by each village as a result of his advice. The departments which felt most jealous of this individual on their turf, who was well equipped with transport and other facilities, instead of working with him, started working against him. Initially, governments of 44 countries where USAID had launched this program felt that this was the answer to rural poverty. In India, Prime Minister Nehru even declared that this was the panacea of rural poverty. But by late 50s, USAID got disillusioned with the achievements of this program and just closed it. So Amit Khan thought that they really threw the baby with the dirty bathwater instead of improving and removing the program, they just closed it. However, in Pakistan, in late 50s, the Ford Foundation, with the assistance of USAID, established two academies called the Pakistan Academy for Rural Development, one in West Pakistan at Peshawar and the other in Kumila at in East Pakistan, now Bangladesh. Akhtar Hamid Khan, who was an ICS officer, which was the steel framework of the British Empire, had resigned from the service almost 20 years ago when this academy was set up and was in search of a strategy for poverty reduction. And having failed to achieve that objective, he had decided to become principal of a college in Kumila. Now at this time, one of his batchmates, one of his colleagues in the Indian Civil Service, now called Civil Service of Pakistan, was the chief secretary in the then East Pakistan. He called him and said, "Akhtar, you are a fool, but a good fool. Now that you are in search of solving the problem of rural poverty, why don't you become the director of this academy and experiment whatever you want to do?" He accepted the position, and fortunately for me, I just joined the Civil Service of Pakistan and was posted to the Eastern Wing, being a federal employee. And I was an assistant commissioner, that is in charge, field officer in charge of a subdivision called Brahman Barrier. And that is when I came in contact with Akhtar Hamid Khan and the academy. And I learned from him the holistic approach to rural development, which had three: setting up of a viable unit for development administration, fostering a Thana rural works program, a Thana irrigation program. Thana was the basic unit which he called the viable unit for development administration. And this center was to act as the devolution or devolving of government departments, and all the government departments, their representatives came to this level. And it was hoped that they would launch a health, education, livestock, forestry, family planning, etc. programs to benefit the people. Of course, with the emergence of Bangladesh, and Akhtar Hamid Khan, although he never wanted to come from there, but during the troubled days, the army forced him to come to West Pakistan. And this was in 1971, and in 1972, the new government, it approached Akhtar Hamid Khan to launch what he called an integrated rural development program. Taking advantage of his presence in West Pakistan, I somehow got myself posted to the Pakistan Academy for Rural Development in Peshawar. The IRDP program was basically supposed to be implemented all over Pakistan, and all the departments, they were asked to have a demonstration pilot of IRDP. The academy also was given one, and that is where I thought of initiating something on the lines of Kumila, because Kumila pilot project had become world famous. And in fact, so the South Koreans, they fashioned their Samulundong program on the lines of. Although Dr. Amit Khan had gone away to Michigan State University as a visiting professor, but he asked me to send my monthly reports to him. And then after a year, he offered to come back to Peshawar as an advisor. And within 2 years, with his mentoring, Dawzi became the viable unit for development administration, which was accepted by government. And the NWP government, now called Pakhtunkhwa, they tried to replicate it in the whole province. But because of the political wranglings and disinformation that I was trying to organize communities against the government and whatnot, both Akhtar Amit Khan and I were thrown out of the academy. I got disillusioned and got a deputation to the United Nations, a UN Center for Regional Development in Japan, where they asked me to write my experiences. I wrote that book, which was published in India. I don't know if you can get it now. It was published by Vikas Publishers. What I was looking for was something which would be what I had done at Dawzi. Unfortunately, the UNICEF approached me there in Japan to be their social development consultant in Mahaveli project. So I came away to Sri Lanka. And in Sri Lanka, in the four and a half years that I was there in Mahaveli Ganga project, I even earned a page in the American magazine Newsweek entitled, it was captioned, A Man Named Khan. And it was there, you know, strange of the ways and snares of fortune. I was approached by the Aga Khan Foundation Geneva to initiate their program in Pakistan called Aga Khan Rural Support Program. As they say, once bitten, twice shy, I persuaded Aga Khan Foundation to get my services on deputation from UNICEF, which they did. And I stayed there for 12 years. And you have heard in the video what I did. IKRSP was evaluated by the foundation. Aga Khan Foundation was able to persuade the Operations Evaluation Division of the World Bank to evaluate IKRSP. And after their first assessment, after 5 years, the bank observed that the first 4 years of IKRSP are the missed 4 years of all World Bank rural development projects, including the World Bank's. And the reason they gave was that those projects went with a blueprint, whereas IKRSP adopted a process approach. On their second evaluation, after 10 years, they said the income of the million people in Gilgit-Baltistan and Chitral, the northern areas of Pakistan, one of the harshest terrain anywhere in the world, the income of the people had more than doubled in real terms. Now, this coincided with the SAARC heads of state setting up an independent South Asia Commission for Poverty Alleviation. And the commission looked at IKRSP and they made an overarching recommendation. The process approach which I was following, they called it social mobilization. And their overarching recommendation to the SAARC heads of state at their summit meeting in 1993 at Dhaka, and I quote, "The centerpiece of a policy framework for poverty alleviation has to be the mobilization of the poor in order to enable them to participate directly in the decisions that affect their lives and prospects." The recommendation was endorsed by SAARC Summit in 1993. The World Bank picked up that recommendation and convened a workshop at Annapolis and invited international organizations, asking them to discuss how this recommendation, which has received endorsement at the highest political level in South Asia, can be operationalized by the South Asian governments. I was also invited to this workshop, because I was also a member of the Poverty Commission. And there I was approached by UNDP New York that would I be willing to take this experiences of AKRSP to South Asian countries. I accepted the challenge for the simple reason that I knew that I'd learned from Akhtar Hamid Khan that you do not replicate programs, you replicate people. I thought that if I can get one person in each country who will understand what we have done in AKRSP, then it can be done. So I was supposed to organize demonstration pilots in the six countries, and Pakistan also got included later on. I took an island in Maldives, which is 14,000. In India, they said that, no, you must take a demonstration pilot of 1 million. I said, it's not a question of 1 million or 10 million. As the Chinese say, the 1,000-mile journey starts with the first step. So let me try it that way. It took me a year to convince them, because being a Pakistani, I mean, they thought what the Pakistani has to teach us. But fortunately, I got that one person. His name was Raju, K. Raju. He was an Indian administrative service officer, a sort of a counterpart of the Pakistan CSP. And he understood. I brought him to Gilgit. And that's another story how I got him there, because you know that's a disputed area. Both India and Pakistan claim that area. But somehow I smuggled him in. And when he saw all that, he said that the first time I've understood what you're saying, that even the poorest of the poor have tremendous potential to rise above the subsistence level. The only challenge is how to help them to unleash their potential. Now, of course, in India, there was a lot of opposition to UNDP's proposal that I should implement it. They launched the South Asia Poverty Alleviation Program. In the commission, the secretary to the Prime Minister was also a member, and he became a great friend of mine. And he told me that when this proposal came, and it came right up to the Prime Minister, because the External Affairs Ministry was not agreeing to it. And he said that, well, he's not a Pakistani, he's a UN official. Send him to my district. So I was packed off to Karnool, which was in Andhra Pradesh. And that is where the program started, the South Asia Poverty Alleviation Program in India. They had a program called Dwarka, Development of Women and Children in Rural Areas. And this was based on the assumption that each woman should save a rupee a day for 6 months. And at the end of that, this group of 15 women, whom they call the self-help group, they will be given an amount of 25,000 rupees. And then they will be able to link themselves up with the banks. As you know, in India, they had a lot of village banks, NABARD and others. So when we went, there were almost 8,000 such self-help groups in the area that we were working. But to my great horror, I found that out of 8,000, there were only 211 who had been able to access money from the bank. The rest have just divided the 25,000 equally, and that was the end of the self-help groups. So we built on that. We said, all right. I persuaded Raju that in Gilgit we had the community organization, here you have self-help group. Let's ask them, as we did in AKRSP, what each household is willing to do, because the poverty is at the household level. And we did that. But the main thing was that what I had learned in AKRSP was the willingness of the community to get organized, because individually they cannot be helped. And this, Dr. Ramit Khan told me he had learned from Rai Faizan, who was mayor of a small principality in Germany in 1849. And he would collect all these subsistence holders and farmers and others and say to them, You are being crushed. The three giants in 1849, the three giants in Germany were the landlord, the moneylender and the shopkeeper. And he said that if you follow three things, then you can overcome the handicaps with which you are suffering. And the first was that individually you can't be helped, you must get organized. And you should also identify an honest and competent leader amongst yourself. And capital is power. So he told them that unless you generate capital through a discipline of savings, you will never be able to attract capital. And third was, of course, that you have the potential. He gave the example of Michelangelo. When Michelangelo used to be praised for his David, he would say, "I have done nothing. David was already in the marble. I simply removed the superfluous material." So even the poorest of the poor, he said, can do this. So that's what I did in AKRSP. I went to the villages and I said that, look, don't give me your problems, your demands, because I can't. But if you follow this, and these were the obligations which they had to do first before we could do anything for them. So it all depends on the willingness of the community to do this. If they don't do that, then nothing can be done. And obviously, for this, they need, whatever you may like to call it, a catalyst, a support organization, as the USAID used to call. And these have to be professionals, trained. And they are the ones who have to really first mobilize them. This is why it is called social mobilization. And to do all this. And unless and until, because each community organization that I have seen has succeeded, there was an honest and competent person. These were, as Dr. Amit Khan used to term, are the diamonds of the community. And unless we could identify them, they, of course, the people had to identify. So with this and a dedicated support organization, and obviously then adequate resources. That's why, you know, that AKRSP was really set up by head of state. Izanus Dawa Khan is known as head of state. And 11 donors came in to support us. And of course, the donor here, of course, in our third world countries, if they accept it, is the government. So basically, in South Asia, in my sojourn of 8 years in Bangladesh, India, Maldives, Nepal, and Sri Lanka, I must tell you, I did not come across a single community which said we can't do anything. So, as far as the obligations are concerned, the poorest of the poor are prepared to fulfill that. And of course, in Andhra Pradesh, the support of the state government to South Asia Poverty Alleviation was absolutely exemplary. I could not have asked for more. In fact, once when the vice president of the World Bank, Miko Nishimozo, was visiting Pakistan, she asked me, because she was great supporter of AKRSP and the rural support programs which came in, and said, "Is this where in any other South Asian countries that can be done?" And I said, "Why don't you come with me to South Asia, to Andhra Pradesh?" And she came and they spent 5 days. And after that, when she met the government officials and the chief minister of Andhra Pradesh, she said, "I have witnessed and I have seen UNDP's miracle. And if you want to take it statewide, the bank will support." And here I will quote what she wrote to me. This was 1998 or 1999. I quote, this is what Miko wrote, "I have just returned to Washington and did not want my time to pass on by before sending you a note of deep appreciation for making my dream visit to Andhra Pradesh possible. Every time I visit South Asia, I learn and grow as a professional. But the visit to India with you was extraordinary in many ways. I gained invaluable insights into the foundation of poverty alleviation as an economist and a development banker. I feel I also grew a little wiser, perhaps as a human being. That fire in my belly is definitely back again, and so are the stars in my eyes. It was one of those trips I wished never to end and felt as if I lived a thousand lives now that it has ended. I do not know how to thank you enough. Thank you all the same from the bottom of my heart and in my soul." Inverted commas closed. UNDP SEPAP phased out in 2002. And World Bank stepped in 2000 after Miko's visit with the Society for Elimination of Rural Poverty, SERP. And Andhra kept on inviting me for advice. On my subsequent visits, I also met the ex-Chief Minister, Chandrababu Naidu, who had initiated SEPAP in 1995. He asked me, how does one reduce poverty, as even achieving 7 to 8% growth rate did not do it. I urged him to visit SEPAP mandals and not to be carried away by campaign modes whereby 5.5 million rural women were organized and rupees 18,000 million was generated as savings capital in 2 years. Without regard to the social mobilization process, which took 7 years in SEPAP mandals to mature. He asked me innocently, can't this process be accomplished in a shorter time frame? I assured him that what SEPAP mandals have achieved in 7 years is no less than a miracle. Even MDGs, the UN wants to be achieved in 15 years. Later, when I met his successor, Mr. Reddy, who was a great supporter of SERP, the rationale for giving interest subsidy that I asked, why are you giving this? He said, it made political sense to do it. If by spending 3,000 million and paying it to commercial banks, they could be persuaded to lend 35,000 million, costing only 3% to the poor people. What better use there could be of public funds? Andhra has been able to demonstrate an approach of poverty reduction encompassing 11 million rural families, which has no parallel anywhere in South Asia. And of course, it happened because of this tremendous political support. I mean, the enlightened leadership of the Indian Rural Development Minister, Jairam Ramesh, he not only supported this, but in 2011, he even tried to replicate it and launched a National Rural Livelihoods Mission, $5.1 billion program, to which World Bank also gave a $1 billion. And expected that it will reach 350 million rural poor of India, 70 million households. Yes. Let me now turn to PowerPoint presentation to explain the reasons, rationale and details of the social mobilization approach. This is the first dialogue which you see on the screen. Now, why social mobilization? I mean, you will see that 20% of the world population consumes 80% of global resources, and the poorest get only 1.3%. And that was the reason why the commission said that social mobilization should be the centerpiece. Obviously, because they said public sector made huge investments, but it does not create the receiving mechanism. It does not involve the communities. And this is why the proposal was that for reducing poverty, improving quality of life, there should be a third pillar to be linked up with the political and administrative pillars. Because none of them could really organize communities, even the local councils, because their function is political education, inter-village planning, coordination of government departments, and taxation if they want to do. But they are not neither equipped nor they can really organize communities. So why we need that? Because this organization has to assess the economic status of each household, prepare a development plan for each household, design products and projects that meet the local requirements, and assess the needs of each village and prepare a village development plan based on villagers' perceptions and aspirations. So what the commission recommended, looking at AKRSP, fostering of socio-economic pillar through social guidance cannot be undertaken by government departments or NGOs. It requires an institutional mechanism which has the resources of the government and flexibility of an NGO, such as rural support program. In fact, when Professor Yunus used to ask me, what are you doing? And I would say that I am trying to persuade government to act like an NGO. He used to laugh. But that's what the commission recommended. It said that implementation strategy of the South Asian countries should be to support financially and administratively the establishment of independent, non-governmental and national level support mechanisms to catalyze formations of, to support financially and administratively both these. So this was really the approach. The approach of social mobilization is to foster a socio-economic pillar which has the resources of the government and flexibility of an NGO. So creating a receiving mechanism which community required social mobilization for harnessing their potential, and basically these are the details, how it helps, identifies, trains, basically prioritizing, undertaking feasibility, facilitating, monitoring. And then the basically the product is this three-tier institutions of the people. Household level, community organization, and when they have organized a village, the village organization, and then they go above the viable unit of development administration, the LSO, or what we call the Thana. So if you want to define the conceptual package, because you know that is what it is, some people say that how this can be applied everywhere. Conceptual package, which is really Raiffeisen's package, and which really was implemented by Japan and all the other countries also, and Semulunong, the latest of Sri Lanka, of South Korea. It is social organization, human resource development, and community. And it is really, it comprises a series of dialogues, poverty ranking, and of course, selection of activists. And it all depends also on a poverty scorecard, which was developed by a Grameen Foundation, USA, Schreiner, developed it, and it was tested in Pakistan and has been accepted by the World Bank here in Pakistan. And all the social protection distribution is really on that basis. The foundation of all this is really the micro investment plan of each household, because the poverty is at that level and from there we go up. So if you want to have a module, a standard module of social mobilization, it will comprise these six: social mobilization, human resource development, credit and savings, technical assistance in natural resource management, development of physical infrastructure and linkages with government departments, local councils, NGOs, commercial and development agencies. And you know, it can also act as a conduit, as a social auditor, and ensure transparent sort of administration and governance. I mean, in my experience, this is the most powerful and dynamic, basically in terms of development process, driving the development process. It's autonomous and sustainable support organization is a necessity. And of course, the organized communities and the government have to work together. Now, these are all details of what it has been achieved in Pakistan. You can see that, and I'm not going to bore you with that. Now, about the regional cooperation which AKRSP achieved, I mean, in terms of Andhra, almost 11.55 million households were, and these were 100% women. And then the National Rural Livelihood Mission says 70 million, as I mentioned to you. Now, this is what Andhra has achieved in terms of the key impacts. You can have a look at that and you will see that it's a very holistic approach. Almost everything that the Bodul requires, that was achieved in Andhra. In fact, the World Bank in 2015 assessment said that this was inspired by SEPAP and rural support programs. Mr. Jairam Ramesh, the Indian Minister for Rural Development, he wrote, Shoaib Khan pioneered the concept through his landmark Aga Khan Rural Support Program. With the support of UNDP, he introduced the concept of poverty reduction through South Asia Poverty Elevation Program in India, which led to a full-fledged program under the Society for Elimination of Rural Poverty in Andhra Pradesh with support of World Bank. The project has seen the journey of over 10 million organized households from despair to hope, from diffidence to confidence, from subjugation to empowerment in the last decade. Their spirit of community empowerment has continued to thrive in India since then. At the behest of Mr. Rahul Gandhi, he visited Uttar Pradesh and helped to reformulate the vision of RGMVP, founded on the same set of core values and beliefs, and thus has much to benefit from Shoaib Khan's vision and effort. The RGMVP website, in the page on advisors, is Shoaib Sultan Khan is a world-renowned expert in rural development and winner of Rahman Magsaysay Award. His pioneer work in India with the World Bank aided Andhra Pradesh Poverty Reduction Project, inspired the setting up of India's National Rural Livelihoods Mission, about which the World Bank has said that the government India's 5.1 billion National Rural Livelihoods Mission is one of the world's largest initiatives to improve the livelihoods of poor rural people. Robert Zaga, Country Director, World Bank. If you are interested in knowing more about the programs which I have described, then again, credit goes to Professor Fayaz Bakr, because he helped it publishing these two books. One is the Aga Khan Rural Support Program, which was published by the Oxford University Press. And the other one is a biography which has been written by an Australian man in the hat. And you're welcome to read them. And in case if anyone of you gets interested in having an internship with RSPs, then do get in touch with me. The American Pakistan Foundation sponsors such people from America. Maybe in Canada there might be some organization which might sponsor such internships. Thank you.